come, it's gonna get you.
I just had to let it go.
One breath.
I was dreaming of the past.
One, two, three, four.
So this is Christmas. Hold on, yo.
Welcome, Brooke Halpin, to Something Came From Baltimore. I've been in a love fest with Brooke Halpin for my show. He has been, which is you, has been very giving of your time and your knowledge of the of Beatles. I call you a Beatle guru. It's so great to have a guest that's willing to really put some thought into everything. And the thing is that you don't have to, because you just know all this stuff, and you kind of blow me away with your knowledge. And we did Paul solo, and that's already out there, and it's been very successful, a lot of good feedback. So
that's great.
So there's only to go back and do John and George, and we just taped George, which will be out later, and we're at part two of this interview together, and we're talking about John. And what's your overall take of John's solo work?
Well, John also had an explosion, completely different from George's floodgates opening. But John, on his first solo album, there is no other recording on the planet that even approaches what Lennon did. It was so unheard of. Nobody sang like John did on the Plastic Ono Band album. Nobody did just bare tracks, piano, bass, drums, minimal production. So he bore his soul. He sang his guts out. He screamed his soul out onto tape. And as far as I'm concerned, that is his best solo album. The second album is wonderful. The Imagined album is also wonderful, but it's not as raw. It's not as bare bones. It's a bit more produced. It's got some strings on there. He brings in Nicky Hopkins, et cetera, et cetera. And then he gets into the political thing sometime in New York City, which I can't even listen to. Mm-hmm. I mean, I just can't listen to that record. And he got involved with Elephant's Memory, which I think was a mistake. I don't like him with Elephant's Memory. But this is all the stuff that was going on at that time. And then Yoko kicks him out, and he ends up in Los Angeles with Harry Nilsson, and they're doing cognac and cocaine all day long. So he's out of his mind, basically, and he's missing and lamenting for Yoko while he's living with May Pang, who's madly in love with him. I mean, it was a mess. So what did he do? He did Walls and Bridges, which, by the way, I think Walls and Bridges is a very, very good, underrated album.
I agree.
I love Walls and Bridges. Mm-hmm. And then he goes back to New York, and he stops. He stops writing, he stops recording, and he becomes Daddy with Sean, and then he doesn't do anything. So there was like 6 years. My God. If he had known, of course, it's a ridiculous thing to say, but if he had known that he wasn't going to be around much longer, he would have been very productive, I'm sure. But he just figured, you know what? I'm done. I've done everything. I'm going to be a daddy, because I wasn't the daddy I was for Julian, so I'm going to be a good daddy for Sean. And then, boom, he does Double Fantasy, and he gets snuffed out. So it's just so heartbreaking when I even say it now to know that that's the truth. That's exactly what happened. So, therefore, we don't have a lot to pull from for John. Just 6 years of nothing. You know, he didn't write, and he wrote a couple of things, but he wasn't really producing or writing much. So it's really an absolute shame what happened. But thank God we've got what we do have from him.
Agree with you. If you look at the 70s, I mean, I understand why he would take a break. He had the immigration issue. He was living in New York. He was totally involved in that scene. He looked like he pulled away from it. And he's like, you know, he was putting an album out every year, you know, up until, you know, Walls and Bridges. And he was like, okay, well, I just need to unplug a little. And, you know, it's not uncommon now for an artist to put an album out, a big monster album, and then back away. You don't hear from them for 3 years. But
that's nowadays. That wasn't the scene back then, though.
Oh, no. You had to produce. And
yeah.
And the fact that he did that was really shocking. People were like, oh, my God, what happened to him? And he's very concerned. I know people would go up to New York just to see if he was what he was doing. Like, you know, like, what is he doing now? Can I, you know, get a look at him? It comes out with a monster album. Double Fantasy is a lot of fun. It's a great album, well produced, perfect for the time. Again, it's very, very John. He's speaking from his heart on all those songs. And John Lennon could have been a really unstable person, and he came off as just really like someone who's down to earth, who is, you know, been through a lot. He knew how to explain his life as to what happened and to why. You know, he was talking about Bed In for Peace, and he was talking about his love for Yoko. And while all that stuff was going down, we just never saw a rock star do any of this stuff. You know, it was almost really over the top, you know, where you're naked on an album cover. And he explained it as a very logical, artistic kind of an expression, and it made a lot of sense. And I was like, okay, you know, it wasn't like he was, it looked like he was shot out of a cannon. The Beatles were over and he was going AWOL. And he experienced a lot, but he seemed to get his act together. And let's talk about that first album, because I look at the first two albums as classic. The Plastic Ono Band album to me is, I have Remember, you have Remember down. To me, that song is pre-punk. I look at that as anyone who listened to that, the way it's minimal, it's stripped down, it's the piano. Yeah. Dun, 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 dun. I can see like future punks like listening to that saying, okay, I get it. I see it's very primal. And, you know, early punk songs were, you know, a minute or 2 minutes long. But in this case, you know, this is a, like a 4 minute song, three, but it's really, to me, like the beginning of what punk would be like. And I don't think he did that on purpose. I think his intention was to be as raw and as real as possible.
That's right. Absolutely. Yeah, that song, of course, it's all based upon the pounding piano, the relentless piano part that he plays on that song. All it is piano, bass, and drums.
Yeah.
You know, that's all there is on there. And, of course, his voice, which goes right through you, you know, and he's talking about, you know, remembering when he was a kid and your mom and your dad, you know, they wanted to be a star and all that stuff. And then, of course, it explodes. The ending of the song actually explodes, you know, about Guy Fawkes Day in England, you know, when they shoot off the firecrackers in November. So it's that whole album, parts of the album are actually scary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
They're almost scary. Like, I Found Out is a scary track, you know. That's a scary track.
Yes.
But again, in the context of things, he's studying the primal scream with Dr. Yanov out here in Los Angeles. And John believed it. John believed that he had to dig down and tear up all of this buried pain and trauma that occurred in his life when he was a child, when his dad left him, when his mother left him, when his mother was killed when he was 17 years old, et cetera, et cetera. So it all came out on tape. Nobody did this.
No.
This is just so mind-blowing. I mean, the whole album just to this day. I mean, from the very beginning. I mean, for God's sake, Mother. Listen to the way he sings the out chorus on Mother. His vocals. Nobody can sing like that. So it's a complete, unique, standalone album that no one can touch. And he did it in 1970, and thank God we have the album today.
Yeah.
And that's one reason why, as you can see on my list, you know, I've got what? Well, I've got God, which we'll talk about, Love, Mother, Remember. So there's four songs right there, all off the first album.
I believe when Rolling Stone did their first top 100 albums of all time, this is in the top 10.
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
It's weird because, I mean, there's no real singles off the album.
No, there's no single.
And
the whole album is a single.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you just can't get any better. And it's not dated. It doesn't stagnate. It's one of the best albums out there of all time. So
yeah.
With that, we're really excited to talk about some of those songs. I want you to go through your first, and I don't know. Do you want to stay on those songs, or you want to go in the order that you have?
Well, no. Let's since we're talking about that album, let's talk about the songs on that album.
All right.
And for me, even though I picked four songs from that album, the song "God" is absolutely earth-shattering.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, when I first heard that. And he's rattling off. Well, first of all, he says, God is a concept by which we measure our pain. If that isn't enough, then he says, I'll say it again.
Yeah.
That's how much he meant it, that he had to repeat it again. And then he goes into this whole list of things that he doesn't believe in anymore. Oh, my God, what is he going to say? He goes through this whole list, and it includes Elvis, and it includes Zimmerman, which, of course, is Bob Dylan. But then he says, I don't believe in Beatles. And when he said that, the music stopped, which was perfect. Because if he doesn't believe in the Beatles anymore, the music stopped. The Beatles broke up. The music stopped. The Beatles broke up. The entire music industry fell on their knees going, what in the hell are we going to do now?
Mm-hmm.
Because the Beatles led the way for everybody in the industry. And when he said, I don't believe in Beatles, that because people still had some hope. Oh, you know what? Eh, maybe 6 months from now, maybe a year from now, the Beatles will get back in the studio and they'll do another album. I mean, those rumors persisted up until the day that John Lennon died.
That's right.
So in 1970, for him to say, I don't believe in Beatles, it was like, hey, folks, the dream is over. Forget about me getting back together with Paul. You know, that's what he was saying. And people were just shocked and stunned by that. So it's a masterpiece. It's, again, it's a song that no one else could have written. No one can write a song like that. And he did it. He did it first. And it's a mind blower. To this very day, it's a mind blower. You got Billy Preston playing piano as well as John playing piano on that track as well. So that's one additional musician other than Ringo. You know, Ringo's on drums for the whole album. And then, of course, you got Klaus Voormann playing bass. But, I mean, wouldn't you agree that God is just mind-blowing?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's... there was a Mantra, Gita. Yeah, he's just going down the list, but
yeah, he went down the whole list. Yeah.
Yoga.
Yeah. Yoga. Yeah.
He's like, I just believe in me, Yoko and me. That's reality.
Yoko and me. That's right. Yeah.
The dream is over. What can I say? Yeah, yeah. It's gut wrenching, and I think that makes people mad because he's just putting a stamp on it, saying it's over. And yep. Where people are like, come on. I mean, I you know, up until his death, I'm like, please get back together. So, I mean, that makes you mad to say, okay, well, you're saying it's over, but we don't want it to be over.
Right.
And I love the fact that it's a gospel. It's, you know, it's very gospel-y. And I'm sure that Billy Preston put that whole thing in there.
It's piano part.
Yeah, it's like a whole church-like, old-style gospel hymn.
Yeah.
Love it. I total fan. I'm actually a fan of everything that you wrote on here. It just didn't make it.
Say,
What else you got from this album?
Okay, well then love. Love is real. Real is love. Love is wanting to be loved. Love is asking to be loved. My gosh.
Mm-hmm.
He just put it out there, you know? It was so open, so honest, so sincere. Right on, is putting it right to you. And Phil Spector plays a beautiful piano part on that song. It fades in with the piano, and then it fades out with the piano. And to me, it's one of the best love songs ever written. It's absolutely gorgeous song.
Beautiful. Yep. Yeah. Perfection and its simplicity. Beautiful.
Yep.
And its content. And I think it's, there was a Cotton commercial with it on at some time.
Really? That's a shame. That's a shame.
But
good Lord.
What a wonderful song.
By the way, it's interesting that you've got the gut-wrenching screaming his brains out, screaming his soul out, where his voice is just so raw. And yet, it goes 180 degrees to this sweet vocal. Love is free, free is love. It's so contrary to the other tracks on the album, where he's just ripping. So again, it's a good portrayal of the diversity, the diverse range that John Lennon had as vocalist.
Love it. Awesome. What's the next one off of this album?
Okay, Mother. It opens with the Big Ben ringing 4 o'clock, which is interesting. I flipped that. When I first heard that, at that time, Tom, I was recording in New York City with a band called 4 o'clock. Honest to God. So I put the record on, and I hear the clock. I'm going, oh, that's interesting. 1, 2, 3, 4. And then, Mother, you had me. So it was like, oh, my God, maybe he knows about my band. But anyhow, mother, again, we talked a little bit about it, and bearing his soul and the pain. That's it. The emotional pain that is in the out chorus, it goes right through you. I mean, it can bring you to tears, for God's sake.
Yeah.
The pain that he's got in his voice. And again, no one can do it. Nobody could do this other than John Lennon at that time. So then we go into Remember. We talked a little bit about Remember already. And a very powerful song. It's just that unrelenting, pounding, banging away at that piano, which is very powerful and infectious. So those are the four songs that I wrote as some of my top ten from John's first solo album, Plastic Ono Band.
Yeah, you know. No one. I mean, the Beatles were the biggest stars in the world. And let's say Elvis. Like, you know, Elvis is coming off of a great album. He would never go into the depth of his soul to reach out and to put out an album like this. Like, no one famous would just say, okay, this is the insides of my body. Like, take a look.
Right. The honesty, such honesty.
Yeah. And there it's just, and believe it or not, once you get over that, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful album. You know, even the album cover, it's like, just leave us alone. We're in our haze. We're underneath a tree. This is where we want to be. All right. So I'm loving the album. I love Imagine too. I have a little more Imagine than you have on it. But let's go through the rest of your songs.
Okay. Well, by the way, I wanted to add one thing. That the Plastic Ono Band, that John's first album, was recorded around the same time that George did All Things Must Pass. Phil Spector produced both records. But Ringo has said, because Ringo obviously was on all of the tracks on the Plastic Ono Band album, he said he rarely saw Phil Spector in the studio when they were recording the album. And I believe Ringo, because Phil Spector is known for what? The bombastic wall of sound of overproducing things like he did with George and All Things Must Pass. And this is a bare-bone production. Mm-hmm. So, and it also credits John and Yoko as producers on the album. So I think that John produced this album far more than Phil did, but he gave Phil credit for some reason. I think Phil mixed it. I think that's what it boils down to. So I just wanted to add that before we get into the Imagine album.
I'm sick and tired of hearing things from uptight, short-sighted, narrow-minded hypocrites. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth. I've had enough of reading things by neurotic, psychotic, pig-headed politicians. All I want is the truth. Just give me some truth.
So then we go to the Imagine album. I guess we can do that. And Give Me Some Truth, of course, blows. I mean, that just blows everything away.
Yep.
It's so powerful. The repetitive guitar arpeggiated ding 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 kind of thing. It drives. It's a driving, powerful song. His vocal is phenomenal on this track. And George Harrison's lead guitar solo is perfect for the song.
Yep.
So, I mean, what he's saying, I mean, obviously it's very political. No son of Tricky Dicky's going to Mother Hubbard soft salt me with a pocket full of hope. I mean, good God. You know, of course, he was going through all this stuff with Hoover, and he was trying to stay in the States, and he was on the hit list and all that stuff. So that's where all that comes from. But he was sick and tired of it. He wanted truth. He believed in the truth. That's what he's saying in the lyrics, and that's what he wanted. And he wasn't getting the truth, so he thought, okay, well, here's my song. Give me some truth.
Mm-hmm.
And it's right up there. I mean, it's right up there.
It's an amazing rock song. And it's, even though you could just take out Tricky Dicky and put Donald Trump in there, and it'd be the same song. It doesn't change.
It would be Rumpy Trumpy.
Yeah. Wow, it blows you away. You know, this one album was tough, and I love this album. I Don't Want to Be a Soldier was up there too, and I had to pull it off. Give me
really?
Some. Yeah, I love that song. Number seven is Give Me Some Truth for me, and I just, it's just rock bliss. It's just awesome. I can't really explain it other than there's nothing false about it. And it's you could see that it's leading to his next album, like somewhere in New York. But right on. Love it.
Talk about Jealous Guy on the same record, which, as you probably know, he wrote that back in the original version was Child of Nature. That was the original lyric for the song, for the music. Back in 68, he was messing around with that after being in India and coming back and all that time. But Jealous Guy, it's like, again, bearing his soul. Now, who is he jealous of is the question, Tom. Who was he jealous of? I didn't mean to hurt you. I'm sorry that I made you cry. I'm just a jealous guy. Who was he jealous of? I was feeling insecure. You might not love me anymore. I was thinking of the past. And my heart was beating fast. Who's he talking about? Who's he jealous of, Tom?
Gee. I mean, it could have been started out with Cynthia, but then it could have went right to Yoko.
Well, what is he jealous of Yoko about?
No, it's just,
what's he got to be jealous about Yoko?
I mean, men, you know, talking to her, or do you have an answer for this one?
Well, yeah, I do. I think, and again, on the same record, he's doing How Do You Sleep, which we know was an absolute direct stab at Mr. Paul McCartney.
Yeah.
Now, knowing how complex John was, he could be scathing and mean and crass, and then he can turn around and be the sweetest guy in the world. So it's like, hey, how do you sleep? And then it's like, I didn't mean to hurt you. I'm sorry that I made you cry. I was thinking of the past. What's the past? The past is him with the Beatles. That's the past. I mean, what's his past with Yoko in 1971? 71, his past with Yoko is maybe 3 years, right? 3 years. So I'm thinking that he was kind of offering an olive branch to Paul. Whether he got it or not, I don't know. And maybe no one else will agree with what I'm saying. But that's just how I feel when I listen to it. He's kind of jealous of McCartney in a way. Because McCartney is, you know, the happy-go-lucky guy, supposedly. You know, he's got the great life going on with Linda now. And he's got wings going on. He's got his own band. That's what I think. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, it's a good theory. Go ahead. I don't want to interrupt. Aside from that.
Yeah, so you kind of agree? I mean, can you understand why I'm saying what I'm saying?
I remember in interviews where he did say he was jealous of Paul. And, you know, he really couldn't stop downgrading his albums, you know, up until, I guess, Paul McCartney 2. You know, he was always asked to critique it, and he just was never... He was jealous of the success, but he didn't like
the
songs.
Yes, right.
And that's what
right.
he said. I'm jealous of the success, but I don't like the songs.
Right. That's right.
So, I mean, I do see a correlation with that. But, wow, what a song lyric.
How can I go forward when I don't know which way I'm facing? How
just don't know how to feel.
Very similar to that is on the same record is How.
Mm-hmm.
Those two songs to me are very similar in terms of what he's saying, questioning things. I mean, he's here's a guy who was one of the Beatles, and he's asking, how can I go forward when I don't know which way to turn?
Yeah.
I mean, good Lord, what is this guy doing? I mean, he's, again, lyrically, this is very similar to the Plastic Ono Band album. Very similar, I'd say. This, without, you know, without, with a different production, with a different arrangement, this would be a song on the first album.
I agree. Yeah, it's amazing. It's my number three of his.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just, it's a, another dead on. It's so weird how those first two albums are just really just raw, and then it goes, he goes elsewhere. And I, you have to know him about Walls and Bridges and, you know, to know what he's, Steel and Glass and stuff, what, like what he's trying to say. But the veil was off on those two albums.
Nobody loves you when you're down and out. Nobody sees you when you're on cloud nine. Everybody's hustling for a buck and a dime. I'll scratch your back and you scratch mine. Been across to the other side. I've shown you everything. I got nothing to hide. And still you ask me, do I love you? What it is, what it is. All I can tell you is, it's all show.
Nobody loves you when you're down and out?
Oh, yeah. Oh, boy. This, to me, is an underrated song. Mm-hmm. I think it deserves more recognition. It's really in two distinct different parts. You know, one part is really just down. You know, nobody loves you until you're 6 foot in the ground. I mean, you, I'll scratch your back and you knife mine. I mean, good God. Mm-hmm. I mean, lyrically, it's like, it's so John just saying it. But then he goes into the middle bit, you know, where he's screaming this whole part. And so it's like two different songs, really, that kind of fuse together. And they work because it provides the perfect contrast. So, and musically, I think it's brilliant. The way, I love the production on it. I just love the song. I think it's a great song.
I think it's a great song too. And there's a demo version of him just doing this by himself, and it's awesome too. Some of the demos that got released after his passing from the Lennon
box. Yes, I have that recording.
Yeah, I think that's one of the highlights of that whole demo package, is that when he did this song, it's great. All right, so you got your number 10 or your last one on your list.
Yeah, now we talked a little bit about John's last album, Double Fantasy. Now, you know that it's not John's solo album. It's John and Yoko's album. So, therefore, it's not all John's songs. He doesn't have that many songs on the record, Tom. Because Yoko's got her songs on there.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's not like, you know, John doing a solo album with all his songs. No. We're grateful for what we got, but it's not a song filled with all John's songs. So, for me, I love watching The Wheels, because he says, I just had to let it go.
Yeah.
I just had to let all this being on the merry-go-round, which of course was the music industry and the Beatles, he just had to let it go, and he stayed home and he made bread, you know, and he brought up Sean. But musically, I love the riff, the piano riff. I love the production. To me, even though I do love Woman, which is on the same record, Woman is a beautiful love song. But for me, this one really, really says where he was at the time. That's one of the reasons why I love it so much.
Yeah. People ask me questions, ask me what I'm doing.
Right.
It's a dialogue with his fans as watching The Wheels.
Yep.
And, you know, I think when people get older in their life, they're like, yeah, he's dead on. Like, everyone needs to just step back a little, take a breather, and figure out what's important in this life. And we had that at 9/11, where everyone was having that conversation. Okay, this is a value to me. And now we've kind of went, we're having another conversation. What's a value to us now? So. That's a personal diary entry, and it's awesome. It's a great album. I love that album. I really don't like the naked version of it, or the stripped down one that came out. I don't know why that's there. Isn't there like a Double Fantasy stripped?
Well, it's, you know, they do that for the hungry Beatles fans who want something in addition to what they already have.
Mm.
You know, it's just, it's like Let It Be Naked. I mean, good God, I hate that record. I hate it. They destroyed the witticism. They took John's witticisms out, you know, all the fun that they were having. Good God, I hate it. So, that, you know, they just, it's money, it's marketing, it's business. Hey, let's do a naked this. Hey, let's do a naked that, make more record sales.
It was really unnecessary.
It's unnecessary. I agree.
All right, so some of the things that you mentioned are some of the things that I love. I think we're on target of the genius of John.
Hey Tom, can I just take a short break for a minute here?
Oh yeah, sure.
And pick up with what you just said.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, give me a couple of minutes. I'll be right back. Hang on.
I did rank it. I do like Somewhere in New York City for what it is. It's like a it's a folk album, like at the minute. Like this is what's going on right now in New York City. With that said, there's some like Attica, and some good songs on there. I like Angela Davis for some reason. I'm a fan of hers, and followed her. You know, I feel she's an amazing woman. I admire her greatly. But when I heard the song, I was like, oh my God, it's Angela. It's like, it matches the woman that I really adore. So, I went as Angela Davis to, a party for Halloween. People didn't get it, but I like,
wow.
Yeah. I mean, that's extreme. But, so this song is like a gift from John and Yoko, who say, we like Angela. We love her. And I was like, wow, yeah. I feel like I'm very proud of them to acknowledge her. And it's a lot, you know, to talk about Angela Davis in 1972. It wasn't the popular thing to do. Angela. The next song that I have is a B-side from Mind Games. It was the Mind Games B-side, and it is really obscure. It's called Meat City. I don't know what he means, but when the album, the 45 came out, I bought it, and the apple is on the front, but on the back, it's the back of the apple. And in this case, it was just a white. It was white and empty. It had no information as to what that song was called. So we loved, as a kid, Meat City, and played it over and over, more than Mind Games. And we thought it meant Six City. And we would sing Six City, Six City. And it was years later until I found out it was like, oh, it's Meat City. And yeah. I'm assuming it's the meat packing plant. It's something about New York City.
Well, that's true. That's true. There is the meat packing district down in the Lower West Side, but I think he's talking about something different. You know, meat can be interpreted many different ways, Tom, as you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's the meat market, like if you go to a pickup bar to pick up someone, you know, to have fun with. You know, they call it a meat market, meat city. Yeah, I don't know. I for me, it can be a number of different things. But that may be part of it, because New York City, you know, that's where he was at the time. You know, it is kind of like a big meat market in a way.
Mm-hmm. And so maybe that's, he was in Greenwich Village at the time, right, before he went to the Dakota.
Yeah.
Number eight. This is my addition. I had to think about it. I came out of church today and I said, I got to scrap one of this and put this one on, which is Cold Turkey.
Oh, you know, I'm so glad you did that because I wanted that to be on my list and I forgot to put it on my list. So thank you, Tom.
Yeah, Cold Turkey is
brilliant.
You know, and this is that wave of what mega superstar is going to sing about their withdrawals from heroin? I mean, it's insane, you know?
Yeah.
And this is the swirl of what he was doing. And what a great song. The song is fantastic.
Oh, my God. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's singing about, you can hear him going through withdrawals vocally.
Yeah.
He's going through heroin withdrawal from like getting his fix.
Yeah.
It's mind-blowing. It came out in late 69. Eric Clapton plays guitar with John. The guitar riff is just mind-blowing. I mean, the guitar riff is so damn good.
Mm-hmm.
And you know what's interesting, too, about this song? Is that he was actually doing Primal Therapy a year before he did Primal Therapy.
Yeah.
Vocally.
Yeah, this is it.
He's doing the Primal Scream, and he didn't even know he was doing the Primal Scream.
Mm-hmm.
He was digging up. Because, you know, I mean, going through withdrawal, I mean, you're dealing with pain, you're dealing with all that stuff that goes along with the Cold Turkey. So, yeah, he's screaming. You can hear him screaming at the end of the record. So, interesting that this would be kind of like the precursor to what would be on his first solo album a year later.
Yeah, and they could have threw that right on there and have been fine. But pop history, pop classic, rock classic, never heard on the radio, banned all over the place. Amazing song. And anyone who is an artist would have this type of song in their catalog would be just proud. This is just a knockoff. This is like, this is what I'm feeling at the time. This is what I'm going through. Here's a single. It's like, wow.
<Are you kidding?
laughs>
Jesus.
What a single.
John Lennon. Oh.
You know, there's other songs that I put on and off, like Power to the People, and it got too confusing, but even Give Peace a Chance, Imagine, there's so much stuff, but when it's number six, I did Nine Dreams, and five to me is considered to me as kind of shocking, and is Every Man Loves a Woman. Or every man has a woman. And the only reason I have that is that I love the Yoko version, I love the John version, and I love the message of the song. I think it's a wedding song almost. And I believe that the ending, the whole instrumental it's very, very commercial today. It doesn't feel dated. And I know that Yoko went back and made a disco hit out of it, and it's a great disco song. I like this song. It's my favorite on Double Fantasy, but I like both versions. I like Yoko and I like John.
Oh, okay. All right.
You don't have any feedback on that one?
Well, it doesn't. There's so much to choose from that it didn't even enter my mind, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
But one that I wanted to put on the list as my number 11, if you will, is Bless You. Now, do you know the song Bless You from Walls and Bridges?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, my God, his vocal, again, it's just dreamy John vocal.
Mm-hmm.
Bless you wherever you are. It's just gorgeous. And musically, it's very different for John. You know, the style of the music. But anyhow, I didn't mean to interrupt your list. So let's get back on with Tom's list.
Yeah. It's okay. Well, because we're getting excited, and that's the beauty of John, is that there's a lot to get excited about. The one I dumped off the top 10 is Free to People, which is also on Walls and Bridges. Is it Mind Game or Walls and Bridges?
I think it's Mind Game.
Mind Game. It's just... that song was played on the radio as a kid, as a rock staple, and I was like, oh, okay. I didn't even know it was John Lennon until later when I got the cassette of Mind Game. I went, oh, wow, I know this song. It's a great song. It's a little reggae-ish. He tried to kind of do a world beat to it. It's fun, but I had to get rid of it. I had to put cold turkey on.
Yeah. Okay. Good call, Tom. That was a good slice on that one.
All right. On number four, okay. I have "Look at Me."
Look at me. Who am I supposed to be? Who am I supposed to be? Look at me. What am I supposed to be? What am I supposed to be? Look at me. Supposed to do here I am. What can I do for you? What can I do for you? Here I am. Oh, my love.
"Look at Me" is just beautiful. You know, it's right into the vein of being raw and looking at your partner and just saying, "This is who I am." It's
"Look at me. Who am I supposed to be?"
Yeah. Yeah.
Again, those questions, John, probing himself.
"How" is three, "Remember" is two, and "Oh My Love" is number one for me.
Oh my.
Oh, yeah, that's a beauty. That's George Harrison playing the guitar and Nicky Hopkins playing the piano.
Oh, it's perfect. It's a, Oh My Love, for the first time in my life, my eyes are wide open.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Oh, God.
Everything is clear in my world. It's...
Yep.
That's very John-like. George-like, if you think about it. But it's almost like a nursery rhyme, and it, I don't know, I just never get sick of it. All right, well, we did that. We had fun. We got excited. We threw some more songs in. There's just a wealth of just really good stuff of John. It, what I was thinking while we were doing this prep is that there is a lot of songs that... were demo-ish that John played on. I don't know why they can't, you know, do more Real Love and just kind of play around with it. I guess it's a little too late. This is me still begging for a Beatles reunion. But some of some of these outtakes are just pretty cool. And I think that the anthology didn't hit some of them, like that Circles from George Harrison. It didn't focus on that song.
Yeah, there's a couple of stuff that John did with using a drum machine at the Dakota that, you know, knowing the technological advances that are around today and the engineering wizardry, you know, you would think that they might be able to take some of his vocals somehow if they could extrapolate it, and then they get Paul and Ringo to add their tracks to John's track. That would be something else. You know, there's the Now and Then. That's the famous one. That was the Now and Then was going to be the third song on the Beatles' third anthology. But George didn't want to do it because structurally it didn't appeal to him.
Mm-hmm.
The structure of the song is very unusual. It's not like verse, verse, chorus, verse, bridge. No, it's just kind of very strange, and George didn't take a shine to it. So... But that's around, you know, Now and Then. Maybe McCartney will do something with Now and Then, perhaps.
Yeah, who knows? Hurry up. We're ready.
We're ready.
We'll be there for you. All right, Brooke Halpern, thank you for joining Something Came From Baltimore. Thank you very much for spending your afternoon with me talking about John Lennon. I really appreciate it. Could you tell the audience, like, what's going on with you, where they can find you?
Yeah, the best way to find me is Google my name, Brooke with an E, Halpin, H-A-L, P as in Paul, I-N. Google me. I'm also on Facebook, but that's the best way to do it. I've got books. My books are on Amazon. Do You Really Know the Beatles? A quiz book is on Amazon, and my newest book, Experiencing the Beatles, A Listener's Companion, is also on Amazon. So I would love to hear from the folks in Baltimore, all the way over there on the East Coast, since I'm on the other side of the country. You could always message me on Facebook. I'd love to hear from your listeners, Tom. Maybe they would like to send me a message. That'd be great.
I think that's a great idea.
Something came from Baltimore. Tomorrow. Something came from Baltimore. Something came from Baltimore tomorrow.